Hello, hello.
You okay?
Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Thanks a lot to the organizers for inviting me to be here, especially to Paul Winghoff. So we are going to be talking about the factors that limit VO2 max, especially central factors. That means that we are going to be focusing on the lung and a little bit more on the heart. But we should have in mind that when we are talking about VO2 max, we are talking about the flow of oxygen and that the oxygen is consumed mostly in muscles at maximal exercise, and that the flow of oxygen at the periphery cannot be higher than the oxygen that has gone through the lung. Meaning that if there is a limitation here, this will affect every other step in the chain. So let's see first what is happening at the lung. So VO2 max can be defined or is determined by the product of the lung oxygen diffusing capacity multiplied by the gradient between the alveolar PO2 and the PO2 in the capillary lung. And this alveolar PO2 can be defined by pulmonary ventilation. As far as you keep a high level of pulmonary ventilation, your alveolar PO2 will be high, and then you will be able to keep a high level of VO2. But ventilation may be limiting VO2 mass in some circumstances. And this has been proved by reducing the viscosity of the air by changing nitrogen by helium. And when you do this, and you are subject to do exercise until exhaustion, when you do this at sea level, ventilation is increased by 27%. And this has an impact in alveolar PO2. But because at sea level the saturation of the hemoglobin is already very high at maximal exercise, you have a very little improvement in saturation. And if you don't improve saturation, you don't improve oxygen transport. And consequently, VO2 max is barely changed. In this case, it was non-significantly increased by 2.6%. That probably is a type 2 error, because any small increase in saturation should translate into an improvement in a VO2 max. But if you do the same exercise at 5,000 meters above sea level, what you see is that also ventilation is increased, and in this case even more, 33% more maximal ventilation at exhaustion. And then VO2 max at altitude then is improved very much. This is a 14% improvement, and this is explained because you really improve saturation when you hyperventilate more at altitude. But this is very high altitude, it's 5,000 above sea level. What is going to happen at 2,500 meters where some athletes may be competing? We test this some time ago. Actually, Takeshi Ogawa was doing the study, and he tested long-distance runners of a high level. They had a VO2 max around 65 milliliters per kilo at sea level, and then he tested them at simulated altitude at 2,500 meters above sea level, and VO2 max was reduced because of hypoxia, about 20%. But when they were breathing helium oxygen at altitude, what happened is that they improved VO2 max, and they did substantially. But the runners that were less good, that were having a lower VO2 max, they didn't benefit from breathing helium. So in summary, ventilation may be limiting VO2 max, especially at altitude. Increasing ventilation at altitude could increase VO2 max. But what about the heart as a limiting factor for VO2 max? The heart is determining the flow of blood across the lung, and the flow of blood across the lung determines, in turn, the maximal oxygen transport. And to increase VO2 max, you need to increase the flow of oxygen that is transferred from the lungs to the muscle. And this requires a very high cardiac output. And maximal cardiac output depends on the product of heart rate times stroke volume. And stroke volume is being determined by preload and also afterload, that is the difficulty, the work that the heart has to do to be able to pump blood into the aorta. And in addition, there are other factors that may influence stroke volume that depend on the characteristics and properties of your heart. And this is related to the compliance, the capacity that has the heart to relax fast and enhance the internal volume without an increase of internal pressure. Contractility, the force that is able to generate when it's contracting, and also the way it's contracting, what is called pump mechanics. So, but if we want to study what limits maximal cardiac output, we are in a very difficult situation because we are trying to study something at the limit. So then we thought it will be more easy to study what is limiting maximal cardiac output if we choose a model where we know that the maximal cardiac output is not reached, where the subjects are ending the exercise with a level of maximal cardiac output that is not the real maximal cardiac output. In other words, where we know that there is a functional reserve to increase maximal cardiac output. And this can be achieved at altitude. In chronic hypoxia, maximal cardiac output is reduced. For example, at 4,000, 5,000 meters, is reduced by 20%. So this provides a very nice model to study what limits maximal cardiac output. And actually, we did this. We went to Chakaltaya in 1997 in an expedition that was led by Ben Saltin. And we had subjects living in this place. This is Mount Illimani, that is 6,300 meters high. And this is at 5,300 meters. They were living there for 9 weeks. And after 9 weeks at this altitude, we performed experiments. And in those experiments, we were trying to test what limits maximal cardiac output, knowing that at altitude, you have a heart that is able to pump more. So the first question is, we were thinking, maybe it's maximal heart rate, because maximal heart rate is reduced at high altitude. And maximal heart rate is regulated depending on the sympathetic tone and the parasympathetic tone. So we know that at altitude there is increased sympathetic activity, catecholamines are high, and there is no insufficient sympathetic activation. We know this. So then we thought, okay, maybe the factor limiting maximal heart rate at altitude is the parasympathetic tone. So what we did to test this was to study our subjects during incremental exercise to exhaustion under normal conditions after 9 weeks of sojourn at altitude. And then we tested them again. But before doing the incremental exercise to exhaustion, we gave them glycopyrrolate, or Robinol is the commercial name. This is a muscarinic blocker. And we gave a dose that we knew that will block almost completely the parasympathetic action on the heart, because we test this previously. What happened is that during exercise at sea level, maximal heart rate was around 180 beats per minute. And after 9 weeks at altitude, it was reduced to 140 beats per minute. And with Robinol, we were able to reestablish the maximal heart rate that we were seeing at sea level. So then this means that actually maximal heart rate is reduced at altitude due to increased parasympathetic tone. But what happened with cardiac output? Cardiac output at altitude, at sea level, was close to 24 liters per minute. And after 9 weeks of sojourn at altitude, was reduced to 20 liters per minute. And with Robinol, nothing happened, actually. We couldn't reestablish cardiac output, despite that we brought back heart rate to the maximal sea levels. So why is this not happening? Could be something related to the altitude. The answer is not, because sometime later, in a study by Stefan Mortensen and Neil Secker, they tested the effect of increasing heart rate in a human doing exercise at sea level in 12 cyclists. And they actually, with a pacemaker, they were able to increase heart rate and by about 15 beats, 20 beats per minute. So they were achieving a much higher cardiac heart rate during maximal exercise. But cardiac output was not affected by the increase in heart rate. So that confirms that you cannot increase your cardiac output just by increasing heart rate. So let's go back to altitude. And at altitude, the maximal cardiac output is reduced, but we know it's not maximal heart rate. So then the cause should be a stroke volume. And a stroke volume could be reduced at altitude due to increased afterload. An afterload may be increased due to the high hematocrit. And actually, to test this possibility, what we did is that we tested our subjects after 9 weeks at altitude, but later we tested them after reducing the hemoglobin concentration to the values that they had before acclimatizing to altitude. And this meant to reduce the hemoglobin concentration by 24%. And to do this, we remove 2 units of blood, and we replace this blood with a solution of dextran 70 to keep the volemia at the same level. And mean arterial pressure at maximal exercise was slightly affected, and cardiac output was the same, was not increased. So this manipulation was thought to reduce afterload, but the effect we had in the blood pressure was very small. So we repeated the experiments some years later. And in this case, we went to Monte Rosa at 4,500 meters above sea level. And we had subjects and volunteers that were staying there for 2 weeks. And we test them after 10 days at altitude. We put some catheters and we measure cardiac output during incremental exercise to exhaustion, but with the particularity that we infuse ATP at maximal vasodilating doses when they were at 220 watts, that was 80% of the VO2 max, into one of the femoral arteries, was in the right leg. And then this produces, with altitude, arterial blood pressure at exhaustion was much higher. So you can see here that the pressure is much higher at altitude, at maximal exercise. And when you are infusing ATP, what is happening is that the blood pressure comes back to the levels that you are seeing at maximal exercise at sea level. And then we look what happened with cardiac output, and cardiac output was reduced with chronic hypoxia, as shown before, but the infusion of ATP that was able to reduce afterload was not affecting or influencing cardiac output. So then we thought, okay, it's not preload, maybe it's not afterload, so maybe it's preload. So to increase preload, what we did is that we infused back the liter of blood that we have previously removed. So our subjects had 5 liters of blood volume in chronic hypoxia after 9 weeks of acclimatization. And then after giving them back this extra liter of blood, the blood volume was increased to 6.1. And then we tested if with a higher blood volume, that means increased preload, they will have an increased cardiac output. And what happened actually is that the cardiac output was not affected by the increase of blood volume by 1 liter. So then if it's not preload, what it is? So in all our experiments, when the subjects were almost exhausted, we asked them to continue the exercise while we switch them very fast to breathe a mild hyperoxic gas that was producing an arterial PO2 just a little bit more than the one that you have at sea level. And then what happened is that they were able to continue the exercise and they were able to have more loads, increases in workload until they were exhausted. And what we saw is that the cardiac output was increased with oxygenation to values similar to the one that we were seeing in these subjects before going to altitude. So then all these experiments show that how difficult it is to manipulate cardiac output. even when you have the possibility of increasing it because you still have a functional reserve. So what about elite athletes? What is the cardiac output plasticity? How can elite athletes have this high cardiac output? Cardiac output depends to a great extent on the size of the heart. And actually, athletic animals, they have a much higher heart in regard to the body mass compared to the human that is having a small heart compared to the body mass of the human. Even elite athletes, they have still a small heart compared to other athletic animals. So, but despite this, the heart of the elite athletes is quite big. And one question that has been around for some time is how can elite athletes achieve this big heart? Could this be done by training? And to answer this question, Benjamin Levine did a study where he had untrained subjects that were physically active but not regularly trained, that were seven men and five women, that were submitted to a program similar to the one that an elite athlete will do, with the aim of running a marathon. And they were training during 1 year and training a lot. And after this training program, they had adaptations in the heart. They increased the left ventricle mass by about 20% after 1 year, and they increased also the left ventricle and diastolic diameter, and this caused an increase in volume of about 20%. But despite these increases in heart dimensions, VO2 max was only improved by 18% after 1 year of training, and cardiac output was improved only by 1.8 liters, that means 9%. But this improvement was already achieved at 3 months. So it doesn't seem to be a factor related to very high volume of training, at least in people that were not conditioning before starting the study. So they look at the compliance, and the compliance of these subjects that were submitted to 1 year of training was slightly improved by the program, but not much, and remained very far away from the compliance that the heart of an elite athlete is having. So that means that with training, you can increase a little bit the size of the heart, you can increase the left ventricle mass, but you can barely influence the compliance. But when I was a small kid, I was looking at the Olympic Games in 1976, and I really liked cyclists. And I'm pretty sure that I was seeing this guy competing. But this was a phenomenal guy because he had a VO2 max of 85 milliliters per kilo, and he was a bronze medalist in 1976. What I didn't know when I was a small kid is that I will meet him in 2013. And then he agreed to have some catheters and he did some exercise. So we measured the heart, and the volume of the heart was huge, 1.4 liter. That's twice as big as the heart of people of his age that were physically active. And he also had a very big femoral artery. And we measure, we know that to have a VO2 max of 85 milliliters per kilo, what you need is to have about 35 liters per minute cardiac output, because you need to be able to achieve a VO2 max of 6 liters. And for this amount, you need this cardiac output. And you can achieve this with a maximal heart rate of 185 to 190 and a stroke volume of 180 and 85 to 192. And of course, we measure this in this elite athlete, and his cardiac output with 71 years of age was 27 and a half. His stroke volume was 201 milliliters per minute. And his maximal heart rate was only 137. But we suppose that when he was young, he was having 184 maximal heart rate, and we suppose that the heart was as big as the one he's having now, and he was able to have a stroke volume that was the same, so he was able to do 37 liters per minute, most likely. So he has aged, but the heart is as big as it was when he was a medalist. So then how is this possible? We have seen that people in the population, if they are submitted to train, they increase the heart a little bit, but he's having a huge heart. So I look at the population data, and the VO2 max of sedentary subjects is having a standard deviation of 0.26 to 0.7 liters per minute. This means that if we assume a Gaussian distribution, that we should have in the population some people that will have a VO2 max of 4.8 liters per minute without training, because they have this natural capacity. And with this VO2 max, you should have a cardiac output between 28 and 34 liters per minute if you assume extraction fractions, systemic extraction fractions between 0.70 and 0.85. So then you need to have this stroke volumes, and you will need between 28 and 34 liters per minute. But this is a theoretical calculation. But I look at the normative data for end-diastolic volumes, and this is coming from a study including 24,400 humans. In this case, I'm showing data that correspond to European men. And you can see here that there is a fraction of the population having a very high end-diastolic volume despite not doing exercise. But if this is not convincing, there is a study where they look at the effect of the training in elite athletes. And after 5.6 years of the training, the left ventricle end-diastolic volume was reduced only by 7%. And the diameter from 61 to 57, meaning that those athletes, they really, when they stop training, the heart is the condition, and it's reducing the heart volume and the ventricle mass, but the reduction is small, and they still have a huge heart even after having been the condition. So this looks that they are like this. But they are like this, they have a big heart. Why? Because this is genetically determined, or because most of them, they start to run when they were very young. Actually, we don't have the answer to this question. So just to summarize, pulmonary ventilation contributes little to the limitation of VO2 max during exercise at sea level. The main factor limiting VO2 max in healthy humans is cardiac output. And the main factor limiting maximal cardiac output is the size of the heart, which is to a large extent determined most likely genetically. Nevertheless, our elite athlete, 70 years old, was having a very big heart and his cardiac output was lower. We still have to answer why this elite athlete is having a lower cardiac output when he has a heart that is healthy and very big. Thank you very much for your attention.